Hello. Today we're going to talk about a conversion of a 250-foot concept design for a global expedition yacht. So this would be a full displacement, probably a 10 to 14 knot hull that is equipped for long range, maximum endurance over 30 days, say 30 to 60 days. And in terms of the range, it's got to be anywhere from 4 to 8,000 miles so you can get across an ocean and still have fuel. This is Grant Maugham's design. I really like it. He's calling it the Raven. So this is about a 240-foot hull here with a probably a 10-foot extension on the back. So we're calling this a 250. The 240-foot class of OSV and PSV was very popular, and there are a number of hulls available that are different age, different price points, and different configurations. And we'll get into that. We're gonna actually go aboard a couple of these. In almost all cases, you're gonna have a touch and go helipad, and you can talk about having a hangar. This vessel's big enough to have its own hangar. It's got some a big opening here for the tender garage. It's got another opening. This would be something that you could open up, which probably goes into a spa or an area for boarding and access. And then you've also got the Euro transom. This is an important door here, and you should pay attention to this, because if you've got guests on board or the owner on board and you have to load in your stores, spare parts, all the things that you need to keep the boat going, this door here will go right into an area that will lead to the walk-in refrigerators, the reefers, your pantries, and we'll also have access into the engine room. So it's got a nice big bridge. That will not all be business. There'll be space up there for the owners and guests. And you'll see on the conversion vessels that we're going to look at it, the commercial ships, that more than likely they're going to have a bridge that's further forward, because that's the way that those boats are built. In this instance, we're going to bring the bridge back. We'll keep the deck house, but we'll probably bring the existing bridge back on the hull. This area of the vessel that looks like the back end of an empty pickup truck is actually full of equipment and weight, and this is ideal for building out for an expedition yacht. So in this particular layout here, it looks actually like they got a hot tub in there, and that's probably a screening room, because you've got lay down pads and what looks like a screen there. Now, on some commercial boats, this actually is the helipad up here. And I don't see any reason why you couldn't do that if you wanted to have a different configuration on the stern. But this creates some protection from sun and weather for an observation deck here for guests and owners to sit up on the bow. One thing I like about this, and that I don't like on some other boats, is you've got the whole crew up here, the whole gang, and it's nice to have a little bit of privacy up on the bow, entertaining or hanging out, and not have the crew there lurking. But that's a matter of taste, I guess. For some people that have large needs for toys, and they're talking about SUVs and ATMs and submarines and motorcycles and all kinds of stuff that they want to bring, having a big beam full displacement boat really does have a lot of advantages. So I have a lot of footage of the boats that I visited down in Louisiana the last time I was down there, but I actually didn't have the right footage for these 240s, and so I decided to jump on a flight and go back down to Louisiana. It was a little toasty. I landed at midnight. It was 88 degrees. And it only got warmer during the day, but it was well worthwhile. And now I'm going to show you a little bit of what I found down there. Today I'm inside of what is probably the largest shed that I've ever seen in Fourchon, Louisiana. About to go aboard this vessel behind me here, 240-foot OSV. I'm going to be taking my cameras aboard three of these 240-foot OSVs, which are just tremendous workhorses in the oil fleet. This one is a 1998 hull. It was built in Louisiana, Sea Carrier. It has a 54-foot beam. And the defining feature of these OSVs is the expansive open aft deck. which can be about 180 feet of open deck by 54 foot on the beam. And not only is it a lot of space, but it has a huge amount of load carrying capability. This hull is almost 25 years old, and these rugged steel hulls hold up extremely well, and you won't see much difference in this hull when compared with a hull on a vessel that's maybe 8 or 10 years old. We managed to get aboard just before a passing thunderstorm, doused the decks, and actually helped cool things off a little bit. We were fortunate to be able to get aboard this vessel as the crew was just finishing up preparations and setting off for the Gulf of Mexico.
These bridges are fairly vast compared to yacht standards. You also immediately notice that you have a 360-degree vantage point.
And all these vessels are equipped with very robust DP2 systems and all of the class-required redundancies. Walking aft to starboard, you have your tank management and all the pump systems, and then the alarms and the fire systems. And despite everything being digital these days, you would still have on all these vessels full sets of manuals. And on the aft side of the bridge is the command station for all of the operations when out at the rig with the redundant DP2 system, and full control of the vessel and tremendous view of the workspace from this aft side of the bridge. There's a nice big nav station here which has all of the normal digital input and data points coming in that you would expect, and then a really nice traditional sized chart table here with all of the chart drawers for the printed charts. And you can see that they are using these in addition to all of the GPS and the digital readouts that they get. I wanted to make note here, although these are U.S. built Cat engine vessels, you'll see Ulstein equipment here and Rolls-Royce.
Both those suppliers are in Norway.
And on top of that, the interiors that we're going to inspect now were fabricated in Norway as well. For an expedition yacht conversion, these facilities are turnkey and ready to go to sea. Temperatures in the 90s, where I wanted to be was here in the cold stores, and even better in the large walk-in freezer compartment, which was chock full for the trip. Here's a typical cabin. It's actually a spare cabin because they're using it for storage right now, but this gives you an idea. The engine room is vast, with at least two decks of height and equipment on all two decks. There's a mezzanine level here. You have Caterpillar mains and Caterpillar generators. There's a full inventory of spares on board and of course workshops. Power management is in the engineering space, which is up high, affording a view of the entire engine room space. I just wanted to jump back out of the tour for a moment here and look at a general arrangement of a typical OSV. This is not the vessel that we're on right now, but it's a typical layout. In this case, the engine room is all the way aft, which is ideal because it isolates your noise, vibration, and exhaust away from the general living quarters. So realize that on the bridge and the crew accommodations that we've been looking at, we're basically looking at the front 15 or 20% of the hull. That whole world is there in the conversion, ready to go. So what we're gonna walk through right now, I just wanted to point out, this is probably about 100 feet of the interior space in the hull where you've got your dry bulk tanks and your liquid mud tanks. And this is all available to be repurposed. So you can extend the crew areas in here. You can put in crew gyms, you can put in a cinema. You've got all kinds of storage. You can have walk-in reefers. Back here is typically on an expedition yacht, it's gonna be part of your garage and your water toys. And so that's the space here. And what I think when I'm talking with clients, something that they don't realize if they're used to 160 foot or 180 foot yacht hulls, where they're trying very hard to find space to put things, they don't realize the incredible open spaces that exist here that we can repurpose. And that is a one of the huge advantages of these offshore supply vessels. So let's go back on board and check it out. So here are your wire runs out in the open, of course, and these are the liquid mud tanks. So they are taking up a space that is probably more than two decks height wise. And you'll see as we walk along here, the pumping station in the at the center of the hull here. And these are all the liquid mud pumps and piping. All that's gonna come out and it's gonna become usable space for our expedition yacht purposes. The glimpse at the independent Ullstein Rolls-Royce Z-drives, which function as part of the DP2 system of the vessel. So here we are on board the 240-foot HOS Sweetwater. This was built in 2009 at British Aerospace Shipyards in Jacksonville, Florida, which at that time was called Atlantic Marine. So it's U.S. built to ABS specs.
Got probably at least 150 because each deck strap is 10 foot.
We're going to turn this inspection over to Darren Petrie, who has deep experience with these vessels, operating them at sea and maintaining them.
E-gen is in here.
Yeah, the net's got more space.
Yeah, now these vessels, the E-gen will backfeed the rest of the ship.
Got a lot larger pantry space,
yeah,
a lot larger galley.
This is more like it.
Yeah, this is more all stainless steel. Got the, we call them reach-in cooler freezer. Then you have your walk-in. You could load this freezer. You can load this freezer from the back door.
Oh, yeah.
It's a watertight door. That's a very good feature. Sure. Again, you have your chain locker. And then this one's a lot larger. You have a lot more storage in here. You're running two bow thruster engines. These are C-32 Caterpillars. They're close to 1,000 horsepower-ish, somewhere in that 1,000 range. On the forward one, we run a, it's the same thrust as the other vessel. It's a Brunvoll FU-63. The forward one has an angle drive. Then it's the two HPU units for each bow thruster. Hydraulic, because it's a hydraulic pitch wheel on the thrusters, which is sweet. Over to the port side is your HPU for your cranes and your anchor windlass. You got your three transformers, 480 to 208.
Now we're walking aft on the starboard side of the hull, past mud tanks on the center line, huge mud tanks, and on the outside wall are corrugated tanks of water and fuel. And here we are at the engine room, all the way aft.
And everything's run neatly up in the open.
Yeah, it's out of the way. It's just so much bigger. It's a deeper hull is what it ends up being. Which makes it
probably
so much nicer.
How many feet to that deck?
I think that's some 18-foot hulls, maybe.
Yeah.
Something of that nature, I'm not really sure. Fuel, all your fuel manifold. Tier 2 engine. You could tell it's a Tier 2 engine on this side where you have the one of the easiest ways to identify Tier 2 is your two pipes going to your after cooler. Then when you're going to go to the Tier 3 engine, your after cooler is going to be even higher. These vessels run a raw water cooled gearbox, which is really easy to work on. Probably when you run into CP wheels is where your fuel efficiency is going to come in versus a fixed wheel. This is your switchboard. This is the B bus. This is the A bus. That's C18 Caterpillar engines pushing 340 kW each. And split rudder system. One electric motor with two pumps. And you can run the whole ship on one motor.
Here we opened up one of the covers looking into the lower bilge. We're actually looking upside down here. I just wanted to see how clean and well-maintained this ship is. It's like new everywhere you look.
CP gearbox, it's a scanner system, variable pitch. This is your leverage arm that changes your pitch. You have a mechanical pump and an electric pump. And as you can tell, this vessel's a lot newer than the last vessel because of the nicer woodwork, the nicer walls. But you have another room here with two-man stateroom. To your right is your captain's day room, what we call.
Yep.
I think it's DP2, then your alarms, and then you have your engine monitoring, your fire alarm system, your EOT, fire pump panel, steering failure panel. And you have your Brunvoll thruster controls up here for your pitch, for your thrusters. And then on the left side, on the right side, is all your engine controls with scanner, your radar. This is part of your DP or your autopilot, radar screens on each side. Again, they have the breaker. Everything's with a new more power.
And you can actually see the bow.
Yeah, because they made the cutout in
the way.
Yeah, they made the cutout in the
ooh.
Our work is more at the stern station than the forward
station.
Yeah,
that's where you're making money.
Yep, correct. They hang out on the stern station, which you could probably tell by the chairs. The stern's usually wore out and the bow's not.
Uh-huh. Chelsea clocks.
Yeah.
Wow, they're all shiny. How are they so shiny?
Because they cleaned them before they got the stack. And they cleaned it from it.
Really?
They came.
Boy, that's ship shape.
So as mentioned at the outset of the video, the task at hand in the conversion is to retain the valuable assets of this hull and the systems that are already on board, reposition the deckhouse and the bridge to a more practical and more aesthetically pleasing position, and to end up with a wonderful global expedition yacht.